Welcome to the Writer Center's virtual craft chat series, where we talk with writers a little less about what they wrote and a little bit more about how they wrote it. My name is Zach Powers. I'm the Director of Communications at the Writer Center, but I'm also a writer of fiction. I have a short story collection and a novel and other publications out there in the world as well. So that's what qualifies me to talk about the craft of whatever this is with our guests when they come on. And I'm really, really excited to welcome our guest today, Lisa Zeidner, who, as I mentioned before, wrote the wonderful book, Who Says, Mastering Point of View in Fiction. It's a great book on the craft. This is the first time we've done a craft chat about a book that is about craft. So we've reached a very, you know, meta-text level. We're fully postmodern at this point. I'm loving it. So Lisa, thank you so much for joining us. I'm really excited to have you here. Just who are you, more or less? Just a quick introduction to you as a person, as a writer.
Well, I'm a novelist. I have 5 novels out. I used to write poetry, but I renounced it. I wrote a couple of screenplays. I've taught since I was in diapers, creative writing. So a lot of time teaching creative writing. I do a lot of reviewing these days, mostly for the Post. Is that enough?
That sounds good. That sounds good. Okay. And you teach at Rutgers?
Rutgers, yes. We have an MFA program in creative writing. So I'm mostly dealing with graduate students now.
Fantastic. And I'm going to refer to you as the recovering poet, Lisa Zeidner, from now on. That's my So, obviously the topic of today, you know, we have craft chats previously, we sort of cover a range of topics. We're really focused on this one topic, and that was a nice challenge for me to keep looking at this topic. And I didn't want to cover everything in the book because I want people to go buy the book and get everything that it offers. But the first thing, I just wanted to talk about your inspiration for the subject. As a reader and writer, I tend to notice more structural elements, just personally. I tend to notice word choice and rhythm and sentence and paragraph structure and variety, and then larger structure things like repetitions and callbacks, symmetries. That's all to say, for me, your book was quite useful. It was drawing my attention to an area where my focus isn't always directed, where probably in a lot of ways I intuit rather than think consciously about. So first, that's a thanks for this book, because it's in an area where I don't necessarily direct my attention. But why is the subject of point of view important to you?
Well, after all of the years I've taught, I've come to realize that a lot of writers think about point of view in a really rudimentary way. They get something's third person, they get something's first person, they get second person is kind of weird. But there isn't a whole lot more breakdown than that. And you know, point of view is really complicated. When I try to read the academic literature on it, I'm lost. And I anyway think academic writing is pretty useless to writers, you know, who aren't writing term papers. So I started thinking maybe I could break it down in ways that are clearer. The other thing I've noticed over a long time of teaching is that everyone has seen a lot more movies than they've read books, a lot more, and a lot more television. So people's ideas about point of view really tend to be what you'd see on a screen, not really what you're writing on the page. So that started to really interest me, is how could you get people to think about how you get to character on the page versus when you're seeing an actor doing a performance. So that was sort of how I got into it as a topic.
Great, yeah. So just off the cuff, was this inspired at all by your teaching experience? Is this something?
Oh, yeah. I'm totally inspired by that. And inspired by the fact that, for example, if you have a student trying to do a very closely aligned third person where they're in the head of the protagonist, they're still showing the protagonist from outside. And you're really having to explain, if you're in your character's head, unless that character is looking in a mirror, that character doesn't know how she looks, right? It's very hard to get interior into a character. and it takes a lot of focus on just specifics of senses and of observation. And it's found that it was really hard for my students to get to that place in their own writing. So I started trying to break it down. And there's like one concept in this book that I hope is really useful and really simple. And that's that point of view is a continuum of distance and closeness to a character. And that every writer is positioning themselves somewhere on this kind of sliding scale of whether they're moving toward the character or whether they're moving away from the character. That's, I'm encouraging people with this book to think about things. So I say in the first chapter, you know, if you're trying to get somebody to feel a romantic kiss, you can't get so close to them that you're in their nostrils, right? You can't get inside their mouths. But on the other hand, if you rear up back so that you've got a Woody Allen lights twinkling on the bridge shot, you're into another kind of cliche. So how do you show what it feels like to be inside a kiss that's neither the nostril shot nor the lights blinking on the harbor? And that's where that kind of sliding scale about where you're positioned in terms of your character comes in. So that's a lot of what I talk about in the book. And I talk about it existing not just in third person, but in first person and every other point of view. And there are many discussed in the book.
Yeah, so is point of view the first thing you notice sort of as a writer and reader? Is that sort of like one of the foundational elements of craft for how you think about craft?
No, I'm like you. I read for the music of a sentence and for the just the creativity and the images and everything. But I argue in the book that all of that goes back to point of view. The way you make the observations goes back to point of view. I'm reading a Chang Rae Lee's new book now, and it's a first person point of view from a 20-year-old kind of surfer dude. It's not the writer himself, but the language is so playful and so wonderful. So I read for language mostly.
I've been wanting to read that book, so you may have just convinced me to.
It's fantastic.
Okay. You've convinced me.
Is that all it took?
I'm pretty easy for book recs. So what are the most common weaknesses in point of view that you come across? What are some, I don't want to say mistakes because I don't believe we're quite that black and white, but what are some transgressions against solid point of view that you see in student writing and in published work?
Biggest one, default omniscience. Biggest one, hands down.
What do you mean by default? Can you define
it? I mean, Sarah opened the heavy oak door and walked in with a sigh. That's what I mean by default omniscience. Just a very flat statement of character's name, action. Mm-hmm.
So I guess, why is that problematic? Because I mean, I think we recognize there's some flatness to it, but you go into the book in this more detail. So I'm the chapter on this, why is that problematic?
Because it doesn't give you any relationship to the events that you're about to experience. It gives you neither an author's feelings about it, nor does it give you the character's emotion. It just gives you a screenplay's account of a gesture. And as I discuss in the book, if you were writing a screenplay, you'd have an actor who would walk through the door in a certain way, right? But you don't have that on the page. You're getting all these questions in chat and I can't see them. Should I? Okay. You're going to see them.
I will read them and let you know when we get to those. So you don't need to worry about those.
Okay.
So you may have just answered this question, but is there a single point of view issue that you wish you could banish from the world once and for all?
Stage directions.
Yes, I love that point of it.
Sarah rolled her eyes. Don't do that, he said, hands on his hips. All right, again, you see what it is. It's a screenplay direction. Mm-hmm. It's not giving you seeing a character and seeing that character in fullness and complexity. So it's, you know, I think a lot of us on a first draft, we go for that stuff and then we have to do a little work, a lot of work to get past that level of observation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I read that note. That was one of the things that I put little tabs on the sides of my book. And that was like, my agent has a manuscript right now and I was working on it the end of it this weekend and it's like, okay, I'm going to go look for my stage directions. And I know I'm pretty good about not doing them, but I then realized that it's not something that I was consciously seeking out in my writing. So you've already helped me in another way, just like that's a new checklist item to make sure I'm not defaulting to a simple stage direction when something else would be better.
Jennifer Weiner today posted that she's going through her manuscript and finding all the size, you know, and somebody else. I mean, unfortunately, I'm friends with a lot of writers, so you hear a lot about their process. Somebody else said he cut 20% of his manuscript just cutting out people's size.
So someone had a good question, which was actually going to be my follow-up too. So can you give an example or two of transforming stage directions into better description? What should you have instead of the stage direction, or what can, maybe not should, but what can you have instead of stage directions?
Who's looking? Who's looking at the person? And how does the person seem to the other person? So, you know, it has to be specific to the observer. It can't be general. So if you're writing a description of sitting across the table from a blind date, and you want to say that the blind date is unappealing because of the way the blind date is eating, the obvious thing you're going to come up with on a first draft is he's chewing with his mouth open, right? Just the standard stuff. But if you dig deeper, you're going to see that the person is going to notice things that are more interesting than that. I think about Flaubert's Madame Bovary's disgust that her husband's spoon clacks against his teeth. You know, when you get that detail in Madame Bovary, you know something about her intolerance, about her feeling of superiority to her husband. And it's really specific. So always it's specificity, and you get to specificity through the senses. And another thing I'd say, and this relates to stage directions, is that there's a lot more sight in people's work than there are other senses. And as Proust taught us with his Madeline, sight isn't the thing that most sticks with us. Smell, texture, sound, these are all things that you can do to prod yourself for a description that's richer and deeper. And you know, the book has, as poor Zach knows from his post-its, over 200 examples. So I really try to find examples that can give ideas about how to do this stuff. And if I can just add, this book doesn't have any whole stories, because I think it's useless when you're teaching to say, read this story, and now we're going to talk about the theme and the ending and the this and that. It doesn't help you with your own writing. So what I'm trying to do in the book is really prompt a way of reading that allows you to rewrite more effectively, because you're looking with a certain kind of closeness at small amounts of things, rather than looking at a whole complete manuscript that you know is a mess and thinking, I don't know what the hell to do with this. You know, there's no way in that.
Yeah, that's great. And it made me think of a little bit too, you're talking about the stage direction in particular, thinking of, you know, the old adage, your dialogue should be doing more than one thing. It shouldn't just provide information. It should have some thematic or subtextual issues as well. And it feels like stage directions do one thing. And the things you're recommending too end up having, they reveal something about character better than a simple state, a simple action, a simple normal human motion that isn't really deserving of comment upon. So yeah, I that's an interesting connection for me in my head now, is like stage directions do one thing and good writing tends to do at least a couple things at a time. So.
And you just said something really important, which is that a good detail reveals the observer as well as the observed, right? Mm-hmm. It's not just Sarah's cute. It's how is Fred looking at Sarah? So I use an example from a Charlie Baxter story where this guy takes a homeless woman out for lunch. And he's noting that she eats fast. And he says she eats like a soldier in a foxhole. And then he notes her pink nail polish is flaking. And we know a lot more about him from those details than we know about her. So you're right that a good detail can cut both ways like that.
So this is from the chat. How about autobiographical writing or memoirs, et cetera? And I think the question is, does these same techniques that we're talking about today, do they apply as readily there?
Well, I have some stuff about that in the book. I have some stuff about it, practically everything. My editor wanted it to be shorter, but let me say two things about that. A first person narrator is very different from a memoir I. When you're writing a memoir, the I is you. The reader trusts that you're speaking, you're not wearing a cat filter, that the person talking is actually you. That's a simple relationship. I argue in the book that a first person narrator is never a simple relationship because there's always some daylight between the author and the character. So they're not the same thing at all. But a lot of these techniques for writing memoir, it worked just as well for writing memoir in terms of getting a voice. I spent a little time in the book discussing writers who do one or the other well. I mean, I'm pretty shitty at memoir. I don't love the voice that I get to writing that. I think a lot of it has to do with how good your memory is, frankly, and mine isn't great. But yeah. I think a lot of these things are useful for the memoirist.
Good. So another question from the chat. Do you have any good in-class exercises you use when you teach point of view?
Yes. And I include a lot of them in the back of the book. We did one. I actually am teaching a craft class in point of view to our graduate students this semester. And we did one today. We did an exercise where you describe a character from the outside. I use an example from Doctorow's Ragtime in the book, where we're watching Houdini walking down a street with no coat on. And then the point of view switches to a free and direct discourse where we're in his head. And we look at how you make that pivot from an observer of a character to a more internal view of the character. And I just want to note, as a personal confession, that when I started thinking about this subject, it was a colleague of mine, an academic, who said, "What do you do with free and direct discourse?" And I said, "What's free and direct discourse?" I mean, I had no clue. You know, I'm just a writer. I'm not a scholar. That's one of the kinds of exercises. Another kind of exercise in the book, just as an example, is to write a sentence about your character that's like a quick, efficient bio sketch of your character that includes your judgment as a writer. And I give some examples of how that's done as well. So there are a bunch of what is free indirect discourse? I'm so glad you asked, Sarah. That's when you go into a character's head without demarcating it with "she thought" or "she thought to herself." So Sarah walked into the bar. The men all look like shit. Why couldn't she get a better guy? Where obviously those are her thoughts at the end of the sentence and not the author's. That was a terrible example. I could read one from the book if we wanted another one, but it's the pivot to being in a character's head without demarcating it as in the character's head.
I will admit to not having known that term before. And I was thinking too, like, I feel like terminology is both useful and sometimes limiting or exclusionary. So I think the book does a good job of letting us see these terms, but also giving the sort of explanation that you just gave too. So
yeah, you know, can I just say, please do not do this while you're writing a draft. Please don't. I mean, what it's the equivalent of is if you've ever watched a shooting coach school an NBA player in their free throw shots, and they drill and they drill and they work on their position and they work on their stance. But when they get to the game, they want a hot hand, right? They don't want to be having a little person on their shoulder going, am I in the right point of view? So these are all questions for revision. And what happens, as you know, Zach, if you've rewritten 8 million times, is that every time you go to write something new, your initial impulses get better. So even if the piece winds up being garbage and you throw it out, you've learned something that you take to the next thing.
I feel like so much of, I mean, yes, you start internalizing elements of craft, but the conscious right. thought of craft is always revision. It's always coming back and looking at, get the stuff down, then come back and fix it if you can. And that's, I mean, I feel like that's the hardest lesson for even, you know, early grad students in creative writing programs, is to realize that first thing you wrote is not the thing.
Can I be permitted to read please. One passage? This is the kind of analysis we do in the book, because I mentioned this E.L. Doctorow passage. It's only like 7 sentences, but please. Listen to what he does. Houdini walked through the streets. His ears burned with humiliation. He wore a hat with the brim turned down. He wore a tight-fitting double-breasted linen jacket and kept his hands in the pocket of the jacket. He wore tan trousers and brown and white shoes with pointed toes. It was a chilly autumn afternoon and most people wore coats. He moved swiftly through the crowded New York streets. He was incredibly lithe. There was a kind of act that used the real world for its stage. He couldn't touch it. For all his achievements, he was a trickster, an illusionist, a mere magician. So you see what he did there? We're watching him from the outside. He's walking through the streets. And we get something meaningful from the description. He's both closed in because he's not wearing a coat, but he's also exposed because he's cold, right? And he's kind of parting the crowds. But what is he talking about? The fact that nobody gives a shit about him as a musician, right? So the picture is not only evocative, but it gives you something about its emotional state. And then Doctorow does that pivot. There was a kind of act that used the real world for its stage. And you know immediately that you're in Houdini's head, that that isn't Doctorow himself speaking. And that is free indirect discourse. I'm done now.
Thank you. No, that was super helpful, because I think the terms are useful if you want them, but the ideas are the thing you're looking for there. So
Another
question from the chat. I just did want to mention again, please keep your questions coming in. Just type them into the chat window. And these are great questions so far. So I would much rather use your questions than the ones I have written here. So please keep the questions coming. How do you feel about using more than one point of view in a novel, both type and character? For example, writing some portions in one character's third person limited POV and others in another character's first person.
I feel a lot better about it than I used to before. Some recent novels did it really well. I mean, I discussed this at length in the book. It used to be that if you sent any, I'm sorry that I'm always looking over here, but you guys are all over on the side except for Zach. So it used to be if you sent something to an editor that did that, they'd say, this is a mess. You know, you're not allowed to do this. It was the don't wear white after Labor Day rule. You know, it was inviolable. But these days, lots of people experiment with that. And there are some good novels that do so. What's Taffy Ackerman's novel called? Brodesser Acker?
Don't know off the top of my head. If someone knows, put it in the chat for us.
Fleischman is in trouble.
Yeah.
That does that. And And now, as you know, a gazillion things have serial third-person limited point of view. And third-person limited just means not that it's small, just that it is limited to the perception of that character, right? So lots and lots of novels do that, tons. And it's kind of the direction that omniscience has gone, to a series of connected characters.
So another question from the chat, and I hope this one doesn't put you too much on the spot, because it's, I think it's related to our stage directions question, but not something that I necessarily have a thought off the top of my head. How does a writer come up with original figures of speech that go beyond the cliched ones? So if the cliched simple stage direction actions, how do you come up with things that are not that sort of simple cliche answer?
Practice and work. And again, evolving the senses, really learning to reach for the senses. I quote a great Walter Kern story from a kid's point of view, where he's putting a pill into a dog's mouth and he's crushing the pill in food. And he says, to describe what it felt like, he says, like hiding a stone in a snowball. Fantastic. Like only a 14-year-old boy would come up with that image. And it's so vivid and so revealing. But you know, that's the work you do as a writer, learning to see the world in a way that's really your own. And I think somebody on chat mentioned girl. Is that right?
I didn't see at the bottom.
I don't know which novel was being mentioned, but
I didn't see that one pop up, but
okay. I'm reading while talking, so I'm not reading very well.
I think too, I think the practice issue is it, that it's, if you first learn to recognize when you are being cliche, then you can revise that later too. So it's like, let yourself write the cliche in a draft. I mean, like eyes like pools or whatever you want to do, that's fine, do it. Let it sit there and then come back and recognize that's the cliche you did. And
I mean, there are different kinds of writers. I have a colleague who I adore who writes in her first draft. He looked at her N and then says, TK, I don't have time now for whatever the hell is happening here. I'm the kind of writer that I fuss with every sentence until I believe for that moment that I can move ahead. I do not recommend that as a method. that's why my colleague writes a lot more than I do.
That should be a question. That should be like our standard question from now on is, what is a thing you do as a writer that you absolutely do not recommend that anyone else adopt? And that might be yours. Someone did mention that I believe I used the phrase recovering poet. That was not the phrase that Lisa used herself, Yasmin. So that was not her phrase. That was just a question about why you use that phrase. That was me joking about the fact that she used to write poetry and doesn't write poetry any longer. What is a novel or perhaps several that handle point of view in a way that you love?
Oh my God, that's a fair question. I mean, there are 200 examples in the book. I love practically all of them, except for the couple I make fun of. Chang Rae Lee is on my mind right now. This is a fantastic act of witty ventriloquism he does for the voice of this kid in this book. But I could name many, many others.
Great. So, back to poetry, to what extent does your background in poetry inform your lens on point of view? They can't help but think of Nicole Krauss's The History of Love, which uses poetry background to reveal point of view details.
In fairness, I wrote poetry so long ago that it probably doesn't inform anything anymore. I went to grad school as a poet, and while I was in grad school, I just liked the fiction better, the writers better, so I switched over. I liked the fiction writers because they talked about mortgages and food, and the poets only talked about trees and moonlight, and I realized I was more of a mortgage and food kind of girl. But, certainly I care about imagery, and I think good imagery can get you really far as a writer, but not every writer is a spinner of metaphors. You know, you can also write a lot of good stuff that has a simpler, sturdier more muscular style of prose. You know, and I also talk in the book about how a lot of this is a matter of taste. I mean, do you like ornate sentences? Do you like reading them? Does Henry James make you want to kill yourself, or does he fill you with delight? Does Hemingway make you want to kill yourself, or do you appreciate the sparseness of the prose? You know, these are partly taste matters.
Yeah, I agree with that completely. So looking at third person omniscient and third person limited, this question is, say, how do you use third person omniscient with third person limited in a novel, but also how do you prevent head hopping if you are sticking with, if you're in a limited point of view? Does that make sense?
Not quite.
Well, I guess, is it possible to balance? I mean, I guess third person omniscient, are there instances of third person limited moments of that within a third person omniscient? Is third person omniscient truly omniscient, or there are third person omniscient novels that are actually more a series of third person limited jumping into single heads at a time?
Yeah, I mean, it's, I think one of the things that's hardest to do, and frankly, a lot more writers seem to be working in first person these days. I don't know about all of you. Are you working in first person? Can we take a poll? Does Amy have a poll going on the side here? But I feel like people are more comfortable with the kind of declarative slanginess of a first person voice, and that third person, I don't know how to do, either do I. third person is harder to come by, I think. It's harder to get a voice going in that. But yes, plenty of people, you can think of it as, you know, they're walking along in their omniscient viewpoint and they say, oh, here's a lap pool. I think I'm going to dip into, you know, John's point of view here. And they kind of step in and then they step out into the stream of their own voice.
Yeah, I'm launching that poll, so we will let that go on while I've never done a poll before, so we will see if this works. It's happening. There's okay.
People are actually.
We have 1 second. We have 1 second person point of view, which really thrills me, just for the record, that someone is in fact, I almost didn't include it. Two. Okay, this is great. We'll come back to that.
I discuss second person at some length in the book. It's tricky. Mm-hmm. For a bunch of reasons. And the main thing I stress about second person point of view is that people in workshops will say it's more immediate and that it puts you into the story. On the contrary, I believe that second person always is kind of alienating because you're actually not doing the thing that the you in the book does, right?
I think it's inherently postmodern. It's like you can't not be postmodern the moment where you throw you at somebody.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. I mean, I like second person. I think it often works better in short stories than in novels. But there are a couple of really good novels in second person.
Great. All right. So yeah, here was the comment about girl, women, other that came up. That novel approaches POV in a way that I hadn't read before. Have you read that book?
I haven't.
Okay, well then we won't ask the question about it because you won't be able to comment.
Okay, should I? I'm going to write it down. You know, it one of the sad things about writing a book like this is that no matter how current you're trying to be, by the end of it, you're going to have missed some things. So. This book does not have in it Charles Yu's Interior Chinatown, which has long sections written in screenplay form because that wasn't out when I wrote the book. So there are always kind of new twists coming up and new examples.
Yeah. So the next question is great because it aligns with some of my other questions I had. And one of my categories was point of view as it connects to other elements of craft. And I think one of the things you argue in the book effectively is that a lot of the other things we consider problems with other elements of craft actually have their roots in poor point of view decisions in terms of just this broader thinking about the manuscript. So this question is, I have a draft young adult novel written in first person present. anything I should be looking out for as I edit that would ruin that? Do you cover tense in your book too? Which you do. You do.
Okay. Yeah. I sort of feel like Elizabeth Warren. I have a comment on that in my book. I have an app for that. But yeah, I do talk about present tense. I talk about it in terms of the uses of temporal distance as a way of controlling the narrative. So like second person, present tense is hard because you're taking the reader through every step of what the character does. And sometimes it's useful at key moments to pull back and imply that you, the writer, knows how this is going to end. And you don't have to be in past tense, but those moments can be very powerful. So I do discuss that at some length in the book.
Great. How do you know when to end a free discourse that is going on with your character?
Try to make it snappy. You know, nobody wants to listen to anyone blather on the page. We see enough of that in real life, right? Mm-hmm. So I talk about this a little in the book too. I often use a kind of 10% rule on a revision. I go through and say, what can I cut here? And almost always the dialogue, the descriptions, everything reads better with the cellulite of the prose trimmed away. And the other thing that's useful about that as an exercise is that once you do that, you can also see what's missing. You know, because sometimes when we're writing, we're just kind of trying to keep the motor of the text going, you know? So we're not necessarily on something that's deeply important at that moment. And when you look at that and say, do I really need this? Like, do I need to describe every course of the meal? You know, before they go back to his place. Like, maybe I don't need the meal at all. They had dinner, they went to his place, you know? So I don't remember what the question was, Zach, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I think, let me flip back up. It was how to end a free discourse that is going on with your character.
Yeah. Just see when you know the old Roadrunner cartoons where the Roadrunner would run over the end of the cliff? A lot of times our writing is like that. We're still going, but the scene really could have ended two or three sentences ago, and often is super effective if it ends just a little earlier.
Yeah, sometimes the conclusion is actually not the thing you think is the conclusion, especially in something like an internal thought.
Right.
Can you name again, you mentioned the book told from the 14-year-old boy's perspective. What was the name of that book?
That was a story by Walter Kern in a collection called My Hard Bargain. He's somebody who I think writes pretty well about. Are there people who are writing young male protagonists here? He's somebody who does that very well. Another person is Charles D'Ambrosio, does that very well, I think. But again, in the book, I just try to use quick, snappy, clear examples. You know, because also while you're writing, you don't really have time to go to Zach's bookshelves behind you and read 8,000 books to learn how to do something. You're just trying to grasp hold of your own damn thoughts, you know? So.
So we have another question about present tense, and I'm okay hitting it again just because I think it's an important one to discuss. How do you feel about present tense? Because you write about this some in the book too and covered it some. This person suspects it's too much for a full novel, but for short stories, maybe more likely as a choice. Do you have any additional thoughts on present tense in terms of how it works and how it maybe relates to point of view?
I think the chatter is probably right, that it's easier to maintain it over the course of a shorter period of time, kind of like second person. It helps if the events that are being discussed are really exciting and vital and quick changing, rather than I went to the door, I opened it, Fred was there, I hadn't seen him in a while. How are you, Fred? I say, You know, if it's just like kind of ordinary realism and not much is happening, it starts to seem very mannered, I think. And if I can pull back to the point I was trying to make about who you're hearing, the author or the character, I think when something, when you hear the writer trying to do something, you get a little annoyed, right? Because it pulls you out of the immersion in the story.
Mm-hmm. Right. How do you know if you need to try a different point of view for a character?
Ah, I love this question. One thing that's fun to do is to just try it and see how it sounds. And sometimes it's entirely obvious that it's wrong. And I urge that in the book as something to try. This blind man, an old friend of my wife's, he was coming for dinner. First person Carver's Cathedral. It cannot be in anything but first person, right? There are other things that, another thing is that when you're in first person, you can't know certain things about yourself from the outside. And sometimes those things are important. So it's always fun to experiment with different points of view and see what effects they give you.
Great. So you say in the book, and this is a paraphrase, so pardon me if it's not exactly right, but point of view is maybe more important than something like character or plot, in that they're both like owe so much to point of view, in that point of view influences and defines both of them. You can't have either of those without first establishing point of view. You just mentioned this a little bit here, that the point of view you choose is going to really define how the character appears to the reader. So, I mean, are character and plot the most obvious other elements of craft where you see this happening? But where do you see point of view influencing a piece of writing the most? Where is this influence really, really kind of, where's a profound moment where you see point of view really make a meaningful difference in, it can be maybe either broadly or a specific example, because I know it's kind of a big question.
It is. So I'll just give you one specific, sure, because it's on my mind. I taught it today. I taught a Tom Boyle story called Balto. A drunk father makes his 14-year-old daughter drive a car. They hit a pedestrian. And there's going to be a trial in which she's being told to lie about the fact that she was driving the car. He varies father's point of view, daughter's point of view, father's point of view, daughter's point of view, every two pages of the story. Where am I going with this? Oh, so the unwinding of the plot, what happened to the guy they hit? What's she going to do is kind of managed by Boyle. As the story goes along. And without the dueling points of view, you'd have almost no tension. You'd wonder, why can't the writer just tell me that the father's a drunk and let me know how the girl feels about it? The whole point of the story is the dueling points of view. So that's just one example, but I don't think I answered your question.
No, I think that does answer it. And it's, I mean, sometimes a deliberate choice like that is what makes us, like, as you said, that story couldn't happen without a very deliberate, almost mechanical choice about employing point of view.
Right. And actually, it's not much of a story. You could summarize it in a line. My mother moved to Paris, and my father is a drunk who lost custody of me after his fifth DUI. That's not a story. That's a legal summary, right? So that's a case where the choice about how to tell it is the story. And that story is called Balto. If you look on his website, tcboyle.com, I think, he has it in its entirety on his website. And it's a fantastic example of a story that manages dueling points of view in order to tell a story in a more complex way than you get from either one point of view. Mm-hmm.
So from Paige in the chat. I'm new to writing fiction and I feel intimidated about writing in the first person. Do you have any techniques for creating a first person voice that is distinct and engaging, or does that just come down to characterization?
I'm gonna look in my book and see if I have anything that would answer that.
I will try to hit on it while you're glancing until you're ready.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's, I guess the one of the scary things of first person is equating the first person voice with the author, which is going to happen regardless. And I think that's the source of fear usually with first person. And I guess the answer is yes, that will absolutely happen. And knowing that it will happen, then you can just accept it and hopefully be a little less scared going forward. It'll happen. People, if you write in first, I wrote my new manuscripts in first person, and also present tense, I'm sorry. And it actually has, for the first time probably ever, like significant elements of things I experienced, but it is 95% out of my bum. You know, I just made it up. Took some core experiences and made up the story. So people will absolutely ascribe to me this made up stuff, because there's enough of me in it to make them assume that is the case.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of unsophisticated readers always assume that the author is the character. When I published my second novel, which is about a woman who falls in love with her rapist, for which I was accused of setting back the feminist movement 20 years or something, a lot of the reviews said, in this novel, Lisa Zeidner discusses her own rape. It was like, really? I was not discussing my own rape. They also said that the character was Zoftig, like me. I was like, really? She wasn't, actually. Even the character wasn't. So, yeah, that's one of the annoying things about writing in first person. The elision of writer and character.
Mm-hmm. How does the choice of character influence point of view decisions? What kind of character makes a good first person narrator? What kind of character needs a third person or something else?
Good question. And too complicated to answer quickly. But I guess one of the questions is, does your character need someone to speak for her? Is she inarticulate about her own experiences? Would it be useful to her to have a translator, in a way, of her experiences? And thus you get Robinson's Lila. You know, Lila is illiterate in that book. Almost illiterate and very simple in what she studied. She only went to second grade. So Marilyn Robinson doesn't want to write a whole novel in which the character says things like, this is a line that comes to me from the book, someone like you has got no reason to be with somebody like me. I don't want to read that novel. That would be one example.
And a child, you know,
right?
I think children are like, the perspective of a child is so great to tap into, but not necessarily the language of a child. So a third person limited point of view where you can dip into the child's mind and get those the child's observations can be useful, but you wouldn't want to read 300 pages of the exact thinking in a first person narration from a child, more than likely. So.
Except people did read incredibly close and incredibly loud.
Yeah.
Does that. I do have a chapter on childhood POVs in mm-hmm. here and talk about the term false naif, where we less see the kid being cutesy than feel the writer making a cutesy kid, right? So there's a lot of things to think about diction when you write from a child's point of view. What can a child really say?
Yeah. So we have a question. I do want to get to this one before we have a little time left. So someone was saying that they see a lot of folks saying that head hopping is something to avoid as an author, but as a reader, they enjoy novels that do this. And I think you cover this in the book, so I wanted to hit on it too. Is head hopping a good or a bad thing? And I don't think it's either, but Can you talk a little bit about head hopping, and I guess in this case, third person omniscient, and where it is now, sort of where it's come from? Because you also discuss it. It's sort of a historical artifact of perspectives too, in a way.
What do you mean by head hopping?
I think it's bouncing, like in third person omniscient, jumping from one character's thoughts immediately into another character's thoughts.
You mean in the same paragraph?
Jessica, if you wanted to follow up and answer that, are you speaking of head hopping within a single paragraph or within?
Or just multiple characters whose reactions you cover. I mean, a lot of people do multiple characters whose reactions you cover. And there are, I hear it as within the same chapter. You know who does that? And it makes me a little crazy when he does it is Jonathan Franzen. Most people don't do that so much these days, but Jonathan Franzen still does it.
I'm sure he makes me crazy in several ways.
Yeah, poor Jonathan. I mean, he's really a very good writer, but there's a kind of whiff of self-congratulation that comes off the work that I find a little hard to take.
We didn't talk about this, and it's always a great topic for point of view, is unreliable narrators. How do you feel about unreliable narrators, first of all?
I love them. And I argue in the book that almost all first-person narrators are unreliable because none of us know ourselves. You know, we best we can do is a selfie stick, you know, but we're not really seeing ourselves as other people see us. So by default, a first-person narrator is making a kind of apologia that we have to take with a grain of salt. But there are ways to make a first-person narrator reliable and likable. And I discuss some of those methods as well, ways that you can make your character seem appealing to a reader.
So this question from Karen, a writing teacher told me that a woman could not be successful writing a story with a male protagonist. In your opinion, is she right?
No, she is dead wrong. And I call you to Lauren Grodstein's book, A Friend of the Family, which, as a 25-year-old, she wrote in the point of view of a 50-year-old man. And in fact, every one of her novels is from a male point of view. I have no idea why. And I know her quite well. I don't know why she does that. I think partly to separate herself from the characters so that she has the distance and control to write about the character. And a lot of really good writers will do that. You know, Laurie Moore almost never writes in first person, even though her work is often very autobiographical. She needs the control and the distance of seeing the character as outside of herself. But I applaud you writing male POVs. And if Flaubert can do Madame Bovary and Henry James can do Isabel Archer, then you can do your character too. And don't let anybody tell you you can't. But a proviso, nobody's publishing YA about male characters, because young men do not read. All YA books sell to either young girls or 40-year-old women. And I have a student who wrote a fantastic YA novel about a kind of horny ADD 14-year-old. And they said, this is great, but we can't sell a novel about a boy. So can you make it about a woman, a girl? He was like, no. I can't.
Oh, the publishing industry. That's a whole other conversation we do not have anywhere near the time to get into. So we are at the end of our hour. So Lisa, I do want to thank you so much for joining us today. This has been a fantastic chat. I'm sorry if we didn't get to some of those final questions that came into the chat window, or if I missed any along the way, but this has been great. Please pick up the book, buy the book, buy the book, buy the book, read the book, enjoy the book, learn from the book. It's great reading. It's great reading for writers. So it was really great to have this as a resource. It'll go on my bookshelf to be referenced into the future. So Lisa, thank you so much again. We look forward to seeing you around at more events coming up.
Yeah, and next time I'm in Bethesda, and thank you all for attending, and thanks for the questions. They were really great, and thank you, Zach.